And what the hardware inventory is going to do is it's going to go through our system, and it's going to look using Windows Management Instrumentation, WMI. We can also go in and look at the registry. And the agent, we have a whole bunch of WMI classes, but by default, it's not going to scan all the WMI classes. But you can go in into the properties, and you can change the WMI properties that you do want to go through and scan. Once you have this, in Chapter 5, we talked about assigning them into different collections. We talked about how inventory scans are done on a schedule, and you can change these if you like. Remember that unless you have a problem with the client, all of a sudden there's an issue, or it's going to a management point that we haven't talked to yet, we are going to be doing the vast majority of these scans will be delta scans. They won't be a full scan, but I can do a full scan. We also will keep a history of the scans, and you can look at the current information. I talk about this on the bottom of page 480. It's listed as GS, whereas historic scans, the old scans that we have, they're going to be stored in the SQL database as HS information. That's going to be used in both queries, reports, as well as Resource Explorer. It is going to grab a certain base level of information, whatever it can get. It will grab a little bit about the installation files, mostly by looking at the registry. However, if you want to have more information about the software on a computer, you probably should do a software inventory. So what is it that we decide to inventory? Well, that's controlled by a couple of files. We have these MOF files. MOF stands for Managed Object File. And these particular files, they have them stored in a path that's over on page 480. It's under the Configuration Manager Installation Directory underneath Inboxes, CLI files.src, and then HINV folder. So that's the hardware inventory folder. We have the configuration.mof file. This will identify which classes we want. It'll also register and define WMI classes that we have. WMI has a bunch of registered providers that gives it the information. It goes out and it gathers the information from the systems, and we can use those registered providers to find out what actual hardware we have. When I request this, the configuration.mof file will be part of the polling policy, and so when I go to the management point will say, oh, by the way, this is the stuff that you need to download or that you need to inventory, and I download that configuration.mof file. And then I'll compile it, and I'll use those changes the next time I go through and make the changes. But normally, we're not really going to be using a whole bunch of the configuration MOF file. Instead, I'm going to go in and modify the client settings. This will allow me to edit reporting classes that we have. I can use the default client settings, or I can make custom client settings. This is going to be converted into a reporting policy. And this is going to be downloaded to the clients, and then it's going to store this in the client's WMI repository. They give you the path for that over on page 481. It's root CCM policy machine WMI, and we'll be able to pull this information in. And over on page 282, they show you all of the inventory classes that we have in there. We saw this when we were in chapter 5, and in a couple of pages we'll show it to you again because it's the client settings. By default, we do have some standard reporting classes, and this is a list over on page 482, page 483, page 484, and page 485. But it shows you some of the things that we have, like do you have a modem, what kind of modem do you have, what type of applications do you have, what networking client are you running, what physical memory do you have, what power management do you have a SCSI controller, all the different things that could be useful for us to identify specific machines and help us to set up our collections. Now there's a couple of different types of files we have. We have what are called MIF files. We have what are called the no ID MIF files and the ID MIF files. And the idea is that, okay, we have WMI providers. It gives us a list of the various pieces of hardware. But what if the WMI provider doesn't tell me information about my specific hardware, or doesn't tell me the information that I want about my specific hardware? I can create these MIF files, and what it does is it extends our inventory. And by extending the inventory, what it does is it says, oh, I have these special settings in this MIF or no MIF file, and I want you to go check these as well. So you can use this, and it's such an open standard. You can use this to kind of inventory just about anything if you want to go beyond the standard. Now realize that Microsoft assumes that you know what you're doing. So these no ID MIFs and these ID MIF files are not validated. In other words, they're not going to go in and make sure you didn't screw it up. So you have the potential, if you're handcrafting these, to tell it to go look at stuff that you really shouldn't be digging around in. So you can end up crashing your machine. So usually the best thing is to not use custom MIF files unless you need to, unless they're absolutely necessary. Now, the first one we're going to talk about is the no ID MIF files. They call them a no ID because it's not going to identify a unique client. And these no ID MIF files, what we're going to do is we're going to have them in there, and we will use these during the hardware inventory cycle. And we're not going to send the no ID MIF files to the server, but the data that these files find, those will be added to the hardware inventory that we send to the particular machine. If I create these no ID MIF files, it will identify classes and other information that's in there. And if I want to use this, it has to be stored, and they give you the location. It's underneath the Windows directory, underneath CCM/inventory/no ID MIFs. So that's where we're going to store it. And if I have special classes and I gather up information, these special classes are going to be added into the site database, and that's how we extend it, by saying, oh, we want to inventory this stuff as well. But if I get rid of the no ID MIF file, any of those classes or things associated with the no ID MIF file, the next time that I do the upload, those classes will be removed from the database. So you got to be careful about getting rid of those particular files. Now, we also have an ID MIF file. An ID MIF file is a little bit different in that it does have a unique ID. It's not necessarily attached to a client, but it is collected from the client. And this is for inventory data on devices primarily that are not using Configuration Manager. So this would be anything you have that's embedded. Maybe you have something that is running like a printer, and you want to go in and identify those. This will go in, and you do have size limits that you can put in. They have to be a certain size, and we can collect them. And we can have a maximum custom MIF size. And if we are collecting these MIF files, you're going to collect them and pull them into your site server. They do talk a little bit about the differences between the MIFs and the ID MIF and the no ID MIF. For example, the ID MIF file has a delta header. ID MIF files have a top level group that's the same class, and they have to have a single property. If I remove the ID MIF file, it's not going to do anything to the database. It's not. The no ID MIF file, on the other hand, if I remove that, all of the things that are marked out in that no ID MIF file, well, all of those, including the classes, are going to be removed from the particular database. ID MIF files aren't added to the inventory. The files themselves are sent across the network, but they are processed by the site server. So that is a little bit of hardware inventory, and we're going to get into a lot more detail on it. This is just the general information. On the flip side of this, we also have software inventory. This is going to tell me what files we have, what programs we have, which ones are being used. And sometimes these files will have different names, like you have the Adobe Creative Suite that has this and this and this and this and this. I can combine all of those so that it all shows up under Adobe Creative Suite. You can gather this information from the actual metadata on the file itself. So when I go in and I say, hey, collect this, this file, its name can change, but the metadata associated with the file itself isn't going to change very often. So I can use that to go in and do the inventory. And this can be with known files. It can also be unknown files. Hey, I don't have any detailed information in the header. I can still inventory those. If you have encrypted or compressed files, you can still use them. What'll happen is that they will be unencrypted as they're inventoried and then re-encrypted, or they're going to be uncompressed while they're inventoried and then recompressed. So if I'm doing this with encrypted and compressed files, that means the software inventory can take a little bit more time. And since we're using a lot of this, it could end up bogging down my CPU, bogging down my hard drive. If I'm sending a lot of data across the network, it could even bog down my overall network. But the way that we do these turn on these inventories, I've already shown you this a couple of times in chapter number 5. But what we're going to do is we're going to go into the administration workspace, and we're going to select client settings. Then this is the default one. I showed you how to make a custom one in chapter 5. I'm going to bring up the properties in here, and inside of the properties, you'll notice that we have a couple of settings. We have one for hardware inventory. So this is our hardware inventory. And it'll say, do we have it enabled? I'll say yes. It tells me the schedule. By default, it does it once every 7 days. Now, one thing about this, if I'm using a standard hardware inventory schedule, what it'll do is it will it'll start 7 days from the time that the configuration manager client was installed. And so it could be 2 o'clock in the afternoon, 2 o'clock in the morning, who knows, it just does it whenever it wants, based upon the number of days. However, if I go in and I say I want to make a custom schedule, this custom schedule, everybody that's under this custom schedule will start at the exact same time. And if I have a whole bunch of machines, my management point may get overwhelmed. So be very, very cautious about how you have that set up. We would also put in the maximum delay when I'm doing this hardware inventory. And I can also have the maximum custom MIF file size. And this is in K, it's not 250 meg. We also have the classes. We talked about that. We don't inventory all the classes. So if I say set the classes, this will go in and it'll do a quick query and it'll show you we don't get everything. But if there's certain classes that you may want to have, then you can go in and you can pick from these classes. And they talk, for example, if you're trying to go in and monitor a laptop, the way that you can identify that it's a laptop is if it has a battery, stuff like that. So if there's certain classes that you'd want to do, you'd be able to select those various classes. And then you can also say whether or not you want to collect MIF files. By default, you don't collect any of them, but if you want to, you can collect ID MIF, no ID MIFs, or both of them. And then it is going to store these for you. If I go over into software inventory, we have pretty much the same settings. Is it enabled, is it not? We have the standard 7 days, and we also have a custom schedule if we would like. How much do I do as far as details goes? By default, it's going to do full detail, but I could also say just give me the product or just give me the file information. If I have file types, by default, we don't have any file types at all. So we're not going in and saying these specific file types. What we're doing is we're doing it based off of the WMI classes and the other components that are there by default. So if I do want to have certain files, I could say set file types. Then I go up in here and then I'll specify the type of file that I'm looking for. So let's say that I want to gather everybody's JPEGs. So I'll say it's going to be a asterisk jot JPG. I can do asterisk dot this, asterisk dot that. I can put spaces in there. I can say where this is located. I can say all the hard drives. Or I could say a variable or a path name, and I could put in a path in here or variables. By default, it will do recursion, which means it's gonna go into the subfolders to see if we have it in there. We have that. I can exclude encrypted and compressed. I can also exclude files in the Windows folder, so we won't necessarily add up any of those. Now that's just gonna go and identify them and inventory them. Another thing that we can do is we can go out and collect files. So I can say collect files, and I will go in and I will specify the type of file. This is not highly recommended. It's not, because if you push this out and it turns out that we have a lot of machines that have this file, or we have a lot of machines that have this type of file, so we have a lot of them. These files are going to be collected and they're going to be stored in the database, and they can end up blowing up my system. I can have way too much network traffic from grabbing these files, not to mention the hard drive space to store them. And then the SQL Server has to deal with it, and then System Center has to deal with it. So this functionality has been in place for many, many years, a couple decades. But most people wisely decide not to use it. In fact, the author says it's not really a good idea. In his previous version, the one for 2012, that's the book that we used for the 2012 class, he put in there, don't use it. But here he mollified that a little bit. So I could say, stop file collection when the total size exceeds, and this is in K, so it's not really big, and I can exclude the encrypted and compressed, and of course I can pick where I want to gather these files from. So that makes it easy for us.